Hello guys, welcome to my channel. In this session I will explain UGC NET Economics Paper 2 of January 2017. So here I will show you how to solve the questions one by one. So I will discuss all questions in this session. So let's start the proceedings. Question number 1. The marginal rate of transformation between two goods X and Y is defined as. Here the answer will be MRT XY is equal to MCX by MCY. So before solving this question, first of all we have to know what is the meaning of marginal rate of transformation. Actually the slope of the production possibility curve is known as your marginal rate of transformation, and simply marginal rate of transformation is nothing but the slope of the production possibility frontier. So to find out the slope of any curve, so you have to use by drawing a tangent, and tan theta is equal to p by b. So on the basis of that, perpendicular by base. So by applying the same logic here, the answer will be mcx by mcy, because when you will draw a curve, both sides you have to take the perpendicular side and as well as the base of the figure. Okay, just by dividing you will get the result. Okay, so and also you have to know what is the meaning of production possibility frontier. So it shows basically the possible combination of two goods that can be produced with constant technology and resources per unit of time. So it measures the set of outputs that are feasible given the technology and the amount of inputs. Okay, so there are certain restrictions or there are certain constraints which the producer has to follow while producing any set of any kind of or any amount of goods. Okay, so let's move on to next question. The question is, consider the following statements regarding the expansion path of a farm. So it shows least cost combination for producing different levels of output. The input prices remain constant, and which of the above statement is that true? So here both the statement are true. So I am explaining why. So an expansion path is a curve. Okay, so is a curve in a graph with quantities of two inputs. One is labor and capital. You may consider any kind of variables. Okay, so the path connects optimal input combination as the scale of production expands. So the points on an expansion path occur for the farms isocost curves, okay, and which shows fixed total input cost and its isoquants. Okay, and isoquant shows, as you might have known to all, that it shows the different combination of two inputs that a producer can produce by using its resources. And so when your isocost curve and isoquant will tangent at a particular level of output, that from that from each point we can draw the expansion path. So for this question, to know more about the expansion path of a farm, you may refer to the your microeconomics by Kotsenis. So there you will get the explanation. Okay, so next is the question number 3. The first fundamental theorem of welfare economic requires producers and consumers to be price takers and economic operator at some point on the utility possibility curve, and that there be an efficient market for every commodity. So to if you want to know more about the fundamental theorem of welfare economics, then you can refer your microeconomics by Halvarian, Intermediate Microeconomics, Halvarian. There, in that book you will get more about this, and just you have to remember few things. And first theorem explains that a market will tend towards a competitive equilibrium, that is weakly paired optima, when the market maintains the three conditions. One is there must be complete markets, that means there would be no transaction cost, and because of this each actor has perfect information. Next is the price taking behavior, no monopolist, no easy entry and exit from the market, and local non-satisfaction of preferences, like that is for any original bundle of goods, there is another bundle of goods arbitrarily close to the original bundle, but that is preferred. And this all about your first fundamental theorem of welfare economics. Similarly, your second theorem explains that out of all possible Pareto optimal outcomes, one can achieve any particular one by enacting a lump sum wealth distribution and then letting the market take over. And similarly, your third fundamental theorem is known as your ROS impossibility theorem. Just you want to remember this. Okay, let's move on to the next question. Question 4, which among the following allocation or distribution corresponds to Rawlsian concept of equity? Okay, so to know more about the Rawlsian equity, you may go to your microeconomics by Hal Merriam. So John Rawls is a contemporary moral philosopher at Harvard University who has argued for this principle of justice. So similarly, another interesting welfare function is the minimax, which otherwise known as Rawlsian social welfare function. So this welfare function says that the social welfare of an allocation depends only on the welfare of the host of agent, that is the person with minimal utility. So here answer would be maximize the utility of least well off people. Okay, next question. Under discriminating monopoly, if the elasticity of demand in market 1 is 2 and in market 2 it is 1, so then the price behavior of the monopolist will be answer would be 2 to charge a higher price in market 2. I'm explaining why this will be the answer. Okay, so before starting the solving this question, first of all you have to know what is the meaning of elasticity of demand. So it is nothing but your percentage change in quantity demanded divided by percent change in price. So in the first market, elasticity of demand is 2. That means your quantity demand is more than the change, the percentage change in quantity demand is more than your changes in the price. Okay, so and in the market 2, the elasticity of demand is 1. That means the percentage change in quantity demanded and the percentage change in price is equal. So discriminating monopoly means what? That means the producer will discriminate the imposing price on the certain factors of production. Okay, so here what the producer will do, that means in the second market the change in quantity demand is equal to change in price. Okay, so if you will apply or if you will adopt any discriminant strategy, that means to charge a higher price in market 2 because the quantity demanded has been same or has been constant. So your answer will be option 2. Next is the given the demand function, actually the all the options are wrong. So here answer to all of the above, that was the guess mark was given. Next is the idea of indicative planning was first adopted in which five-year plan of India. So the answer here is the 8th plan. In the 8th plan, planning commission was adopted the idea of indicative planning. So indicative planning means what? It is a form of economic planning implemented by a state in an effort to solve the problem of imperfect information in market and mixed economies in order to increase economic performance. Okay, so indicative planning was first attempted in France. So India's 8th five-year plan, that is 1992 to 1997, attempted to manage the transition from a centrally planned economy Yes. So India's 85 plan attempt to manage the transition from a centrally planned economy to a market oriented economy without tearing the socio cultural framework of the country. And in that plan period, the target growth rate was 5.6%, but the actual growth rate was 6.8%. Let's move on to next question. Under the following statements about Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, so RSBY, two statements have been given, and which of the statement given above is correct? Okay, we want to find out the correct statement. So here, under RSBY, the premium is shared on 85:15 basis by the center and the state government, which is wrong, which is actually this would be 75 and this would be 25. Okay, so this statement is wrong. So it should be 75:25. Next is, in case of the northeastern states and Jammu and Kashmir, because most of the northeastern states and Jammu and Kashmir are coming under the special category status. So there will be some changes in the funding pattern. So under RSBY, the premium is shared in a 90:10 ratio. Yes, because in the case of actually there are two kinds of states in India. Actually, one is the normal states and another one is the special category status states. Okay, in special category status, what's happening? So whatever the loan they will take, they have to they will only return the 10%, and the 90% of the amount will be given them as a premium. So while in case of other states, this would be the opposite, and they have to return I think 70% or 80% amount, and the remaining 10% will be free for them. Okay. Next is here, match the following from the list given below. So just you have to find, you have to remember the year. Okay, so National Rural Employment Program, which was started in 1980. So first one is 2, and here the answer, I'm just saying the explaining the answer actually. So here answer would be 3, option number 3, right? So so NREP 1980 and Sukanya Samriddhi Yojana 2015, and most of the question will come from your government policies and all. Okay, just you have to remember the what are the government recent schemes in India, and what are active and what are inactive schemes, and what are the missions, and most of the year I think 5 to 10 questions will come from or are coming from the government schemes and all. So just you want to remember all the schemes and missions and all. So currently there are actually in India there are 33 schemes are currently active. Okay, and if you talk about the mission, then in India then there are 14 missions. And the project is also project 5 or 6 projects is currently going on, and campaigns also there are 7 current campaigns going on in our country, and IDs also there are 7 IDs, government recognized ID, and lots of scheme has been closed after the NDA came into power. So just you have to remember all those things, because most of the questions are coming from this. Okay, so next question, which of the following has the highest share in India's external debt at the end of March 2015? Okay, so so India's external debt, here the answer would be, I think answer would be 3, the commercial borrowing. Okay, so this kind of questions are repeated in most of the years. So just you have to remember this kind of question. Okay, so just you have to remember the what are the composition of India's external debt: multilateral debt, bilateral debt, IMF and export credit, commercial borrowing, NRA deposits, rupee debt. Okay, next is the long term debt and short term debt, total external debt. So in 2000 by end of 2016, so India's external debt is $456 billion, and in which commercial borrowing shares highest, that is 37.3%, and followed by NRI deposits 26.20%, okay, and after that multilateral 11.1%. Okay, next question. RBI can print currency notes up to the value of 10,000. Okay, it has the power and autonomy to issue notes up to the value of 10,000. So here answer would be 2. Next is Union Budget 2016 imposed a 15% surcharge on the income exceeding rupees 1 crore. Okay, so just you want to remember some of the income tax lapse rates for 2017. Suppose if you are earning up to 2.5 lakh per annum, there will be no tax will be imposed on your income. If you are earning 2.5 lakh to 5 lakh, then 5% tax you have to give to the government, and 5 lakh to 10 lakh, 20% you have to give, and more than 10 lakh, 30%. And surcharge is that besides your tax rate, you have to give another percent of income tax the government. So surcharge is 10% of income tax while the total income exceeds rupees 50 lakh to rupees 1 crore. Okay, so if you are earning rupees 50 lakh to 1 crore, then you have to give the tax rate of 30%, and except that you have to also pay 10% of the income tax. And if your income exceeds rupees 1 crore, then you have to give 15% of income tax surcharge. Okay, and these tax lapse rates for normal citizens, and in case of senior citizen up to 3 lakh nil, and no tax will be given to the government. Up to 3 to 5 lakh they have to give 5%, 5 to 10 lakh they have to give 40%, and above 10 lakh they have to give 30%, and the surcharges remain. And that is 50 lakh to 1 crore 10%, and if income exceeds more than 1 crore, then 15% will be tax rate. And except that also says 3% of total income tax plus surcharges, and among the income tax and surcharge, again 3% will be taken by the government. So, government has been taking huge amount of taxes from the citizen, because if government will not take the tax, then how the economy will run. Okay, so it's like a quid pro quo condition. Okay, give pay the taxes without expecting any direct benefit from the government. So next is, as I have said earlier, that means lots of questions will come from your recent schemes, COs and all, and with some campaigns. So just you have to, before the examination, just you have to have a look on those aspects. Okay. Next is Paramparabhat Krishi Yojana aims to boost drip irrigation, organic farming, horticulture crops and vegetable production. Our answer would be organic farming. So I'm explaining what is organic farming. So it is a component of soil health management of major project, National Mission of Sustainable Agriculture, NMSA. So under PKVY, Paramparabhat Krishi Vikas Yojana. So organic farming is promoted through adoption of organic village by cluster approach and PGS certification. So organic farming means it is a method of crop and livestock production that involves much more than choosing not to use pesticides, fertilizers, genetically modified organisms, antibiotics and growth hormones. Okay. Next is question number 14. Classical dichotomy refers to which of the following? Okay, so here the answer will be option number 2. So classical dichotomy refers to one of the following. So there are two sectors of the economy, namely agriculture and industry. Influence of money is not on the real value like employment and output, but on the price level, saving come only from profits and not from the wages. All the above. So you may refer to your macro books, any macro books you may refer. D and D Vedi also. So this part I have referred D and D Vedi. So you may check D and D Vedi for more details. So dichotomy means a division or a contrast Okay. A dichotomy means a division or contrast between two things or being opposed or split or separation. So classical dichotomy refers to the idea attributed to classical and pre-Keynesian economics that real and nominal variables can be analyzed separately. Economists call separation of real and nominal variables the classical dichotomy. The economists call separation of real and nominal variables as the classical dichotomy. It is a hallmark of classical macroeconomic theory. The classical dichotomy arises because in classical economic theory, changes in the money supply do not influence the real variables. Okay, this relevance of money for real variables is called monetary neutrality. Okay, so change in nominal variable does not affect change in real variables. Okay, if money is neutral, affecting only the price level, not a real variable. Okay, so Keynesian and monetarist rejected the classical dichotomy. Even post Keynesians also true. Okay. Also, they have also rejected this thought, and there was a controversy that is Don Partington challenged the classical dichotomy and developed a real balance effect of changes in the nominal money supply. So next question is the basic rationale of the theory of big pools is based upon the idea of external economies. The answer will be external economies. I am explaining why the answer is external economies. So before that, you have to understand the big push theory. So the originator of this theory was Rosenstein Rodan in 1943. This theory suggests that in the presence of market failures, there is a need for concentrated economy-wide and probably public policy to get the process of economic development underway and to accelerate it. Okay, so it is a modern version of external economies. External economies refers to the benefits which accrue to the individuals and to the society when goods are produced on large scale. So the concept of external economies was first used by Marshall. The external economies have been termed as indivisibilities, and their impact on development has been discussed as there are three indivisibilities discussed by Rodan, and Rodan expressed major hurdle in the process of industrialization was the small size of the market. To overcome this hurdle, actually he has explained the role of indivisibilities, like the three indivisibilities as I have said. One is the indivisibility in production function, indivisibility of demand, so and indivisibility of the supply of savings. Okay, so just you have to remember the three indivisibilities, and the main idea was on the external economies. Okay, so next is the central problem of the theory of economic development is to understand the process by which a community which was previously serving 45% or less of its national income more converts itself into an economy where voluntary saving is running about 12 to 15 of national income or more. When the following economist is attributed with this view, here the answer would be Ragnar Nurse. Okay, so there is a book called Paradigm in Economic Development, Classical Perspectives, Critics and Reflection, Rajanikanth. Okay, so you can refer to this book to get the idea. Actually, direct statement has been asked here. Okay, so next is the Haldemar equation G is equal to S by V, where V is defined as. So here, here the answer would be here. Option number 2, incremental capital ratio. Every year, Haldemar model, one question is compulsory. Okay. So, please have a look on that. Next question, Levinstein in his critical minimum hypothesis treats population as a factor that is income depressing, because Levinstein in his theory, he has discussed about shocks and stimulants. So every economy experiences the influences of the two forces, that shocks and stimulants. SOX refers to the those forces which tend to reduce output, income, employment, and investment. So, and SOX dampen and depress the development process and are called income depressing forces, because population is an income depressing force. Because when the population of a of an economy will increase, then definitely it will have negative impact on the economy. So stimulants refer to those forces which help in raising the level of income, output, employment, investment, etc. So stimulants impress and encourages the development of forces and are called income generating forces. And basically Einstein explained population as an income depressing forces. And according to him, population growth is an increasing function of per capita income up to a certain level of income. Thereafter, it is decreasing function of income. Next is, whom of the following economists was not associated with the dependency theory of development? So here, answer will be Gunnar Myrdal. So the resources flow from a, the dependency theory of development explains, the resources flow from a periphery of war and underdeveloped states to a core of wealthy states, enriching the latter at the expense of former. So next is post number 20, that is here Sevi Mansan used in the neoclassical growth model is focused on Sevi Mansan. Next is on BOP. In every year you will get some high chances that you will get a code, one or two question from the balance of payment of India. So the question is like that, consider the following items in the BOP. So NRE deposits and remittances, which are the following is a part of the capital account of the balance of payment. So before that, you want to know what is the current account and capital account. So current account refers to an account which records all the transactions relating to export and import of goods and services and unilateral transports during a given period of time. So components are export and imports of goods and visible trade and invisible trade, unilateral transfers like your gifts, donation, personal remittances and other one-way transaction without any service in return. Okay, so remittances will come in your current account. Okay, next, a capital account. Capital account is your foreign investment, your loans, banking, rupee debt services, other capital transactions, error and omissions, and your NRI deposits. Okay, so here your answer will be one, only one. Okay, next is only the following is not already asked. The passing better terms of trade is which is correct, and trade risk, deteriorating terms of trade, which you know is also right. Marshall Upper Cup, Swalgas Dumping Conditions, and this is wrong. Okay, so welfare for welfare, Swalgas is famous, welfare economies. So here, just you want to remember, okay, types of just go through the types of terms of trade, okay, and what is meaning of upper terms. Okay, so it's your chance to once go through learning details. Next, the which one following is correct for the discretionary fiscal action. Okay, so here answer would be your option 3, a managed change in level of government spending and or net tax revenue. So discretionary fiscal action actually is it is one in which ad hoc changes are made in the government expenditure and taxation system and tax rates at the discretion of the government as when required. So in discretionary fiscal policy, government makes deliberate changes such as the level and pattern of the taxation, the size and pattern of its expenditure, the size and composition of public debt. Okay, so and the automatic stabilization policy in which government adopting a fiscal system with built-in flexibility of tax revenue and government spending. Built-in flexibility means automatic adjustment in the government expenditure and tax revenue, so in response to rise and fall in GDP. okay, so it is automatic and it is ad hoc. Okay, so next is your Next question is, whom the following called the trade as the handmaid of growth, that is during weak crisis. Next question, for the import substitution policy of Latin America countries in 1950s, which the following is that true? Here it resulted in overwhelmed exchange rate, only one is true. Next, the country the following concept, Leontief paradox, later hypothesis. Which of the following can be read as exception to the conclusion of the Hexer-Olin theorem? And here both 1 and 2 are exceptions. Actually, the Leontief found that US is the most capital abundant country in the world. Exported commodities that were made labor intensive, which is contradiction to your HO theorem. So, next is the Lindell's hypothesis. This hypothesis has proposed by economist Saffron Lindell in 1961. Lindell proposed an alternative theory of trade that was consistent with Leontief paradox. The Lindell hypothesis presents a demand-based theory of trade in contrast to the usual supply-based theories involving federal environment. Lindell hypothesizes that nations with similar demands would develop similar industries. These nations would then trade with each other in similar but differentiated goods. Next question. Which among the following statements are true for the proposed US challengements? It is outdated. So next is economists refer to an unanticipated inflation that reduces the real value of outstanding government debt is known as the inflation tax. Okay, a public good is non-exclusive or non-excludable in nature and non-rival in consumption. So here the answer would be option 1. So a forward shifted tax will affect buyers more than the sellers. So for details regarding this question, you may refer to Public Finance by Radhakrishnan or any kind of book. Okay, maybe thank you also. Next is assume B is a social benefit, C is a social cost and all given here, and the net present value of a project is has been asked here. So here the answer would be the option number 1. So the definition of net present value is it is defined as the difference between the present value of a future income stream and the cost of investment, that is NPV is equal to present value minus cost of the investment. So R1 by 1 plus I plus R2 by 1 plus I whole square plus R3 by 1 plus I whole cube Rn by 1 plus I whole n. So is equal to summation j is equal to 1 over n Rn divided by 1 plus I to the n. By applying the same logic, you will get option 1 with the answer. So next is which refers to the characteristics of non-excludability and non-rivalry law and order is a classical example of a public good. Very simple. Next is the trade cycle theory of JRF. Long run economic growth is determined by here answer the autonomous investment. So trade cycle theory of J.R. Hicks. So Hicks developed his model of trade cycle by combining interaction between multiplier and accelerator with her double growth model. So in his theory, Hicks uses Keynesian concept of saving, investment relationship and the multiplier, Clark's acceleration principle, Samuelson multiplier, accelerator interaction, Haldeman growth model. Next is Stagflation. Which of the following is not characteristic of Stagflation? So here answer would be higher employment. So this is a situation in which the inflation rate is high, the economic growth rate slows, and unemployment remains steadily high. Next is 35. So here is the answer would be both statement 1 and 2 are both statements 1 and 2 are true. Okay, so these are outdated questions. Next is 36, question number 36. So using the following theory approach does not treat consumption to depend upon expected income, that is Keynes approach. Okay, refer to D and D, very good. Then economy, the saving and investment function is given is like that. So the question has been asked is that what is the equal level of what is the equal level of income. So saving given, investment given, just equal investment equal to saving, then you get equal level of income. So S is equal to I, that means minus 100 plus 0.2 I is equal to minus 30 plus 0.1 Y. Just transposing the variables and the constant, you'll get the value of Y, and here the value of Y would be 700. Okay, just equate the two equation, you'll get the result. Next is for the set of observation given, which of the following is the most suitable average. So here median, okay, median would be the suitable average, because if you find out the mean, then this value 100 value will affect this observation, and if you find out the geometric mean also, same thing will happen. That means that means the highest value will affect the smallest value. So the median would be the best one, because 5 is the middle value. Okay, next is what is the random sampling method. So here the systematic sampling method is a random sampling method. From the sampling chapter, every year you get 1 and 2 questions. So please read it thoroughly, and also it will help you in paper 1 also, because in paper 1 also few questions will come, and also other few questions are also coming from sampling part also. So first one is the quota sampling. So it is a method of selecting survey participants. That is a non-probabilistic version of stratified sampling. So purpose is sampling. Next is a purpose is sampling is a non-probability sample that is selected based on characteristics of the population. And the objective of the study is systematic sampling. It is a type of probability sampling method in which sample members from a larger population are selected according to a random starting point at a fixed periodic interval. This interval called sampling interval is calculated by dividing the population size by the desired sample size, and is a cluster sampling. With cluster sampling, the researchers divided the population into separate groups called clusters. Then a simple random sample of clusters selected from the population. Next is variable in minus 3 sigma plus and plus 3 sigma under standard normal curve is 0.9873. Just you have to remember the condition actually. Okay, so just you have to remember the formula, that is distance from the mean ordinates in terms of plus minus sigma and the area under the curve. So if the z value is equal to plus minus 0.6745, then the 50% of the area under the curve, so value would be 0.50. If the z value is equal to plus minus 1, then it will be 0.6826 or 68.26% of the area will be covered by the curve. If z value is equal to plus minus 1.96, then 0.95 area will be covered, and if it is equal to 2, then 0.9544% is. Then if it is 2.58, then 99%. If it is plus minus 3, then it will be 0.9873. Okay, so here the answer would be option number 2. Next is for a symmetrical distribution, skewness is 0. Okay, when the next is the given the following data, number of observations given, arithmetic mean is given, variance is given, the coefficient of variation here. So coefficient of variation formula is standard deviation by mean into 100. So standard deviation is here is standard deviation variance is 324. That means square of the standard deviation is the variance. So just take the root of the variance. So it would be 18. Okay. So 18. Okay, so next is variance is 324, and as you know, the square of the standard deviation is known as variance. So just take the root of the 324, it will be 18. So formula is just if V is equal to coefficient variance equal standard deviation mean into 100. So standard deviation is 18 here, divided by mean is how much, 180 here into 100. So here will be answer will be 10%. Next is which of the following satisfy time reversal test but not factor reversal test. So the answer would be Marshall Edgeworth 10%. The answer would be here the Marshall Edgeworth. Okay, so it satisfies the time reversal test but not factor reversal test. Index the question has been come from index number chapter. So for details, you are able to start fundamental statistics as Gupta. Okay, so next is for testing the aspect of the attributes which of the following test is used. So the chi-square test would be the answer. Okay, statistics, fundamental statistics, S.C. Gupta, please read this book. So some reasoning, just have a look on this, you will get the solution. Okay, thanks for watching.